All right, good morning, church. If you're online or in person, welcome. Thank you guys for being here. If you're on the journey with us in person today, I have been informed that if you're sitting in an economy and you'd like a free upgrade to first, those are available today. Guess those seats were a little too expensive over here. I promise I didn't tell Craig what to read for his opening scripture this morning, but man, did he hit it right on the mark. Because we have been in 1 Corinthians. Let's see, last week we talked about running the race in chapter 9, running the race in order that we might win. What does that take? Well, it takes a lot like the Olympics, right? That's where the analogy kind of comes from. And that's starting for us now, started, right? And running that race takes discipline, training, purpose every day, right? And the point is to win the race at the end. Before that, we were in chapter 8 of 1 Corinthians, and we talked about stumbling blocks. Kind of these two work together really well, don't they, right? If you're running a race, you don't want a stumbling block, so that makes sense. Talked about the idea of, as Christian brothers and sisters, we should be, instead of placing things that might cause our family of Christ to fall away from God, we're instead working to bring them closer to God. So what does that look like for us? Well, it looks like taking things out of the way in our own lives sometimes, but it also sometimes looks like taking action when we don't want to take action, when inaction might be easier. So we've been moving through 1 Corinthians here pretty well, and I'm glad that Craig read in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, because that's where we're going to jump to today. We're going to be going from chapter 9 into chapter 12, and I need to get my Bible open to 1 Corinthians, not Romans, where Larry was at. But we're going to go back to Corinth, and we're going to see what Paul is sharing with the church yet again in this letter he's written to them. So remember where we're at. We're with these people, with this church in Corinthians, all right? With the church in Corinth. But before we jump into the scripture, I want to have a little fun first. I want to talk about something fun. I want to talk about superheroes. Superheroes are cool. Now, I mean, we all know superheroes are awesome, and they've always been awesome, right? But, well, also, let me say this. Lego Batman is one of the best superhero movies ever. Don't have to be a kid to watch it. It's one of the best. But have you noticed that superheroes have kind of had like a resurgence these past 10? I was looking at the years. 2008, so like 10 to 13 years, superheroes have had kind of this resurgence and rebirth. And why is that? Well, it's because of these guys, right? It's because the Marvel superheroes, and they got movies. Started with Iron Man, and then we kind of kept on moving until we get the whole Avengers up here, right? So superheroes are really cool again. Not only are they cool because they've always been cool, but now we have movies that everyone can go watch. The kids think they're cool again. The adults have a good reason to admit it finally again. Superheroes are cool. And we talk about them. They're in our culture, right? So these past 10 or 12 years, they've really been back. And these movies kind of hit, I would say they hit their peak popularity in 2012. That's when the Avengers came out. That's who you see on the screen right here. That's where all the superheroes came together. The superhero squad, I guess you could call them, right? So the Avengers came out, and if you haven't seen these movies, basically the Avengers are all the superheroes coming together, and what do? Well, they come together to defeat the bad guy, of course. It's a superhero movie. So they come together to reign justice over evil and defeat the bad guy. That's what superhero movies do. But in the Avengers, when they're all coming together, it might be a surprise if you haven't watched it before to know that the first half of the movie, these guys aren't together very well at all. First half of this movie, we kind of follow each individual character and how they're not working together as a team. They kind of actually go through some rough patches where they kind of bicker and fight and don't get along, and there's a whole other movie about that with some of them. But they're not getting together, and they're not being a team. They're being a bunch of parts, but not a whole. And so something finally happens, and they have a friend that passes away, and this, actually, Kyler, can you plug in my laptop and make it go through the speakers? Because I forgot to do that. And so, and turn me on there too. All right, and so they come to this point where a friend dies, and something has to change. because they're not working together. And this scene plays.
Yes. We were going to build an arsenal with the Tesseract. I never put all my chips on that number, though, because I was playing something even riskier. There was an idea. Stark knows this. Called the Avengers Initiative. The idea was to bring together a group of remarkable people. See if they could become something more. See if they could work together when we needed them to fight the battles that we never could. Phil Coulson died still believing in that idea. In heroes. Well, it's an old-fashioned notion.
It's an old-fashioned notion. You can kind of tell by the feeling of that whole scene. They're somber, they're sad, they're not working together. Each of these superheroes has a gift, but yet evil has won. It has taken one of their close friends, their colleagues, and they've lost him. And they're sitting there in the room, stuck, failed, if you will. Because each of these superheroes, even though they have gifts that are unhuman, can't defeat evil. And then the guy that was given the motivational speech there, Nick Fury, he tells them that there's this idea where we could take all of you great superheroes and put them together and call them the Avengers. You knew about it. We could have been doing this. Tony Stark gets up and walks away because he didn't like the idea. And he says, yeah, we could be something greater and fight battles that we can never win on our own. Oh, it's an old-fashioned idea. It is an old-fashioned idea. You know what? This idea of the sum of the whole being greater than its parts, we say that in our culture, but do you know how biblical that idea is? Well, Craig read about it this morning. He talked about the body of Christ, and that's exactly what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about us being Avengers instead of just the superheroes that you guys are individually, okay? So 1 Corinthians 12, you can feel free and open up there because we are going to read about this old-fashioned idea that has been in culture all the way back to the beginnings of the church, even for the Corinthians. So if you would, let's go ahead and read about spiritual gifts, about our superpowers in the first couple verses of chapter 12. We'll go ahead and start verses 1 through 3 of 1 Corinthians 12. I'm reading out of the ESV, and it's up on the screen for this first bit. Paul writes, he says, "Now concerning spiritual gifts, brothers, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, you were led astray to mute idols, however you were led. Therefore, I want you to understand that no one speaking in the Spirit of God ever says, Jesus is accursed. And no one can say, Jesus is Lord, except in the Holy Spirit." Okay, it's kind of like we're taking a little break before we even talk about the gifts in the body yet, right? But Paul feels urgently, he needs to say this. So what's he saying? Well, first off, he says, I don't want you to be uninformed. I want to talk to you. I want to tell you. I want to share with you this struggle that you're going to be dealing with. I've seen your struggle before over gifts. In the next chapter, in 13, he talks about how we should love with our gifts. And in chapter 14, it's obvious to see that they kind of struggle over who should be the preacher, who's a prophet, right? And so he's like, I see this struggle. We're going to talk about it for a few chapters, all right? I don't want you to be uninformed. I see the struggle. And then he says, what is a spiritual gift? That's what I'm talking about. What is it? Well, it's never against Jesus. No one speaking in the Spirit of God ever says Jesus is accursed. So what is a spiritual gift? Well, it's not cursing Jesus, okay? Then he goes on to say, and what is a spiritual gift? Well, no one can say Jesus is Lord except in the Holy Spirit. So a spiritual gift, proclaiming Jesus is Lord, something prophets do, preachers do. Who do they do that through? The Holy Spirit. So he doesn't want them to be uninformed, and he tells them, spiritual gifts are not to serve you, they're not from the world, and they definitely aren't against Jesus. But what are they definitely from? Well, they're from God. The Holy Spirit is the one who gives you these gifts. So essentially, he says, gifts point to Christ. Gifts point to Christ, spiritual gifts. All right, let's keep reading here in verse 4, and we'll go ahead and read through verse 11 here together. So we know that the spiritual gifts need to point towards Christ, but what's next? This might be a little small. I invite you to read along in your own Bibles. 1 Corinthians 12, 7 through 11. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. For to one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit. To another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another the ability to distinguish between spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, and to another the interpretation of tongues. All of these are empowered by one and the same Spirit, capital S, Holy Spirit, who apportions to each one individually as he wills. So in verse 7, Paul points to Christ, and he says that these gifts are a manifestation. That's a big word, right? Basically, these gifts are from the Spirit, confirming they're given from the Holy Spirit. And who are they for? Well, for the benefit of the common good. What's the common good here? You ever thought about that? What does that mean? I had to think about that for a little bit while I was writing this sermon. I didn't want to skip over the common good. So I thought about it for a minute. This letter is from Paul, the church planner, to the church that he planted, right? It's not to the city of Corinth. It's to the church in Corinth. So when I was reading this, I was thinking, all right. So the common good is not the common good of the city. It's the common good of their church. That's who this is to, right? So each is given a spiritual gift from the Holy Spirit for the work of the church, for the common good of the church. That's how I interpret it anyway, right? So it's never talking about the broad, but it's talking about serving one another. Then what's it go on to say? Well, it goes on to list some different spiritual gifts. We have wisdom, knowledge, healing, working miracles, prophecy, distinguishing between spirits, talking in various tongues, and interpreting various tongues. Bunch of different spiritual gifts. Some of which we still see very active today, and some of which we're like, man, I wish we kind of had that. Like, or I wish I knew if I had that, right? I'm just kind of guessing what the Holy Spirit gave me sometime. He goes through this list, and he reminds them that these are the gifts that are working for the common good. These are the gifts working in the church. And Paul reminds them it's not about themselves. This is the common good given by the Holy Spirit, not for idols. So it's not about pride. It's about serving the body. Verse 11, he says this. Let me read verse 11 again. All of these are empowered by the one and the same Spirit, who apportions to each one individually as he wills. He reminds them yet again that these are given to you by the Holy Spirit, and he picked them for you, apportioned. He divvied them out based on the people, right? So he's not worried about if you have this gift or you have that gift. The Holy Spirit has given you what he's given you. Use it, right? He's getting to that use it part here in a second. Use it. Don't worry about if yours looks better than someone else's or yours is more public. Just take what the Holy Spirit has given you. And remember, your gift should serve the common good. Should serve the body, not to be proud of yourself, but to be proud of the body. Okay, let's keep reading here. Gifts should serve the body. Let's go ahead and pick up in verse 13. And I am going to read through 26. So that's too much to put up there. I want you to follow along in your own version, all right? 12, 13, and I'm going to read through 26. So almost the end of this chapter. Let's see what Paul has to say. For in one spirit, we were all baptized into one body. Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and all were made to drink in one spirit. For the body does not consist of one member, but many. If the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I don't belong to the body, that what would that make him any less part of the body? Verse 16. And if the ear should say, because I'm not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make him any less part of the body. If a whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God has arranged the members in the body, each of them as he chose. Verse 19 of chapter 12. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, yet there is still one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you. Nor again to the head to the feet, I have no need for you. On the contrary, the parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And on those parts of the body that we think are less honorable, we bestow the greatest honor. Our unpresentable parts are treated with greater modesty, which our more presentable parts, they don't require. But God has so composed the body, giving greater honor to the part that lacked it, that there may be no division in the body, but that the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together. And if one member is honored, all rejoice together. So he's talking about the body of Christ. He gives some great analogy here, right? Because we all understand that our human bodies have lots of different parts. We all understand how important almost all of those parts are. I don't know what the appendix is up to. But the rest of the parts are really, really important. We would never discount how important a certain part is to the rest of our body. See, they're working through this giftedness in Corinth. They're working through this idea of, okay, we are all on the same playing field now. We're not slaves or free. We're not Jews or Greeks. And when we come together, we've been given a role and a gift. They're trying to figure this out. And what he does is he talks about the human body to talk about the body of Christ. When he talks about the human body, he says all those parts are unified. What should the body of Christ be? All those parts unified. And he says, we don't want all the parts to do the same thing. Take, for example, this human body I've been talking about. You don't want a body full of eyes. That makes sense to me. Paul goes on to say, then where would the hearing and the smell be, right? You don't want a body full of noses. What would you see? Absolutely nothing. Right? He says, we don't want all the same thing. We want many different working together for one. You notice what else Paul said in these scriptures here? He said, what we consider some of the most important parts don't get a lot of the glory. That's my revision of it, right? Some of the most important functions of our human body are hidden under modesty, as Paul would say that. And we get a little confused because we think about modesty and like clothing. But think about this. Where's your heart? Can you point to it? It's inside. Where's your brain? It's inside. I would consider those two things the most important pieces of my body, and yet they're hidden in modesty. They're not on display, but we know that they're there, they're functioning, and they're serving the entire body. That's what Paul's saying the church should look like. He's saying this body of Christ should just look like a human body where we all have different parts, and sometimes the most important parts aren't even pretty. The most important parts are hidden in modesty behind the scenes, and you never even know it. It's interesting, if you think about it, we see this in life all over the place. We see the sum of the parts coming together to make something beautiful. A lot. Courtney told me this story that an old man told her a while back, or she heard at church. I can't remember where she told me he was from. But a guy was leading a prayer, and he started his prayer and saying, "Lord, I sure do hate baking powder. Lord, I sure do hate lard. Lord, I ain't even that crazy about raw flour. But man, I love it when you bake some biscuits. After you've been working on us for a while and putting us together and cooking up your recipe, I can't wait to see what you make like biscuits." And we see that all throughout life, from biscuits to that kid who can't play his trumpet, but yet a bunch of instruments together or a grand orchestra. When we put together all the parts to become something grand, how beautiful is it? How beautiful is it when we all come together with what reason? We have to have the same reason, right? There has to be a purpose. And Paul didn't leave that out, did he? Paul said, just like the body comes together with a purpose, or the flour comes together with the lard for the biscuits, it's its purpose. Or the orchestra comes together to make beautiful music, that's its purpose. What is the church's purpose? Well, we come together to effectively be the body of Christ, to serve Christ, to radiate Christ to the world. What's our purpose? Jesus Christ. What's our purpose? The church of Jesus, right? And we understand that in our culture, and that's exactly what we should be doing. We should be being a whole body. So what should we do about spiritual gifts? Well, we each have unique body parts. How about that? We each are unique body parts. Some of you in here might be an eye or a nose or a smelly foot of the church. Even if you're the smelly foot, thank goodness you're here. I like to stand, right? So we each are unique body parts. But if the body isn't working together, it fails. We experience that with our own physical bodies, especially as time goes on. You get older sometimes, you know, that foot just is stuck. It doesn't want to move. Or when I used to work construction, I had trigger finger in one finger, and it would just get stuck sometimes. I'm like, I'm not trying to keep that finger up, guys, but it's just stuck. It's annoying when it doesn't work together. It really fails. So what's Paul saying? He's saying that's exactly the church. Don't be ashamed of what spiritual gift you have or what role you have. On the same hand, don't be proud if you get to stand up on the stage every Sunday. Doesn't make it any better. Maybe I'm the smelly foot. We all have a different part of the body, but it has to work together. Just like the Avengers, the body of Christ needs to come together. In the end of the movie, right, after they finally figured out that they need to come together after that speech. They stop serving themselves. They stop being prideful. They figure out that we need to unify as a team. In the Avengers, they come together as individual superheroes. And you know what they do by the end of the movie? They defeat the bad guy. It's a superhero movie, right? They come together and they defeat the bad guy. Or as Nick Fury, the superhero leader guy, says, you can come together and defeat enemies that we never could. As Christians, you can do a whole lot. But when we come together, we can defeat the enemy like we never could. So this week, guys, this month, this year, this rest of our life, let's practice being a complete, whole, purpose-driven body of Christ. Before I get down from here, I want to give one more announcement before we go to prayers. I want to read this card that was given to the church. It says, "Thank you for your kindness, your generosity, and your caring." I just read this to you. "You're a great example of everything that's right in the world. Our family really appreciates the love, concern, and service that the members of this congregation have shown during the memorial service for our sister, Evelyn. We love you and thank you, and we thank God for you, Evelyn's family." So thank you guys for that. And thank you all for being here this morning. Continue to be the body of Christ.
Okay, superheroes. Let's sing like a bunch of superheroes. job, superheroes. Harold, that was a great analogy. I don't think Betty and I've even seen the Avengers.
Now you know all about it.
Well, enough to get us started anyway. Great lesson. And we always need to talk about, remember, and be part of that body. Okay, let's see. I think we have most of the announcements covered. Do we have any joys we'd like to share this morning? Donna does.
Hi. Well, I asked for prayer last week for my daughter-in-law's brother, Hari, and you know, he lives in Indonesia, and they don't have the medical help that we have and everything. They did find one canister of oxygen for him. He's got, catch you up, he's got COVID, severe case of COVID, and they found a canister of oxygen. And then one of his brothers-in-law and nephew work for the government, so they use their influence to keep it coming. But then he eventually, they found a room for him in the hospital, and as of this morning, he is off of the oxygen and on room air only, but he's still hospitalized. He's doing good. But what hit me the most, I think, was the fact that, you know, we can go to the hospital and we can get the oxygen and the things that we need, and they were scrambling all over the area trying to find him something so he didn't die. But he's better.
That is awesome. That is a joy. Yeah. Harold?
I'll let other people go too, but I just want to say amazing. We're so happy to have Addie back. I'm very, very grateful to see her. She was willing to give me a hug this morning, so that's awesome.
Yeah, we're glad to see her and the family. Okay, anyone else with a joy this morning? The joy is kids get to go to Bible camp.
Absolutely.
Boy, that'll be fun. Chasing chipmunks and squirrels, hearing the word, fellowshipping, food, cabins. What could be better than that, kids? Not much. Do we have any prayer requests this morning?
Continued prayers for Mike Mills and his family and Jason Mueller, both struggling with cancer. And for the family of Ronnie Givens, they'll be having his service tomorrow. He was in a four-wheeler accident and died.
Okay. I think Michael had one there, Harold.
I get you here, Mike. All right, prayers for his second cousin's wife. She's having pregnancy concerns with high blood pressure, and her labs are coming up a little out of norm. So this is the mother of the little boy who was born premature. So just prayers for her in that.
We sure will. Okay, Terry, up front. I'm sorry?
Pray for David. He's got a sinus infection.
Okay. Courtney, did you have one? Oh, okay. Anyone else have a prayer request? Dennis does.
Yeah, I'd like to request prayer for the Irvine family. He's kind of an extended family, I guess, in Lander. They've had one of their men killed in a machinery accident this week. And they've had some other problems and stuff, and I just want to request prayer for their comfort and like that. Maybe direct some of their thoughts more toward the Lord's things.
Sure. And I think the fellow that lost his life in that, I think, is Shirt Tail relation to Duffy. Yes. She's not here this morning, but okay. Any other prayer requests this morning? Harold?
Just prayers for Nicole Nunn's cousin. His name is Drake, and he was in a very bad car accident earlier this week, and we've been praying for him for this week, but things have been really tough. They've just been barely keeping him alive.
Yeah, okay.
So his name is Drake, Nicole's cousin.
Well, hopefully he's young and strong, and the doctors will be able to help him recover. Any other prayer requests this morning?
I just looked online, so I'm sorry.
There you go.
Vicki wants to share, praise God, for the special gift of an air conditioner that was from the church kind of working together this week. And then Duffy is asking for prayers for her family as they move through the coming days. So prayers for her family as they move through the coming days.
Okay. Very good. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer, if you would, please. Thank you, Father, for being the loving God that you are. We love you and we need you, Father, and we rely upon you constantly. We thank you for giving us your comfort and your strength, and we thank you for the words that we've heard here this morning that are so encouraging, and to help remind us that each one of us